Well, congratulations on this book, first of all, Nyle. Thank you for coming to Chicago.
Of course. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah.
This is fantastic. Chicago is a gorgeous city. I've been here twice, but it's always too cold. And I was not the biggest fan. I'm not going to lie. But summertime in Chicago, I'm loving this. This heat is fun.
If anyone was looking at your Instagram, we saw that you went for a run today. You got to enjoy the best part of our city, the lakefront. We hope you...
Honestly, yeah. Absolutely. I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I think my brain is still on East Coast time, but you know, I was typically up at 6, and this morning I thought 5 a.m., why not make a day of it? I went running and I saw that the water was 55 degrees, perfect to reset my body and recover. It was really nice.
Very nice. So the book is out. Let's put it up like this so it looks nice. There we go. The book is out. How does it feel for it to be released into the world and also have it become a bestseller at the same time?
Oh, it's been wild for sure. To be honest with you, if I look back on the 5 years that it took me to write this book, I remember in the beginning my team said, Nyle, you really need to start thinking about putting together a memoir. You need to think about what sort of topics and ideas you want to put into it. And I thought, I don't really have any story to tell. I mean, I consider myself pretty boring, not going to lie to you. I'm a pretty normal, average guy by any measurement, in my opinion. But they... were very interested with the fact that I came from a deaf family, right? So many deaf kids who come from hearing families live a very different life. And for me, we just didn't have too many parallels that made me seem really normal, I guess, in the wider eye of the hearing community that I was working in. So I thought, maybe this is a good idea. In researching, I found that actually 10% of deaf kids out there come from deaf families like mine, which makes that subgroup pretty rare. Right? To be able to pass down deaf culture and deaf community and, of course, American Sign Language, right? That's so built into our schools and, you know, in our everyday lives. That did feel like something that I could tell. You know, I mean, I thought maybe it would be 100 pages, right? But to be able to write this many, I thought, all right, I guess I do have some things to say. But I do think, you know, a few weeks before this was out, I was nervous. And I think that I was nervous because, you know, for 5 years, I've, you know, been working through this industry. And when I look at the change, I've lost every shred of privacy I had, right? I mean, really living in the public eye is a very different experience than what I was expecting when I was planning to be a math teacher. You know, I thought I could handle it, but this is a whole nother level. I mean, I'm literally telling you everything about my life, A to Z. This is a very intimate look. But, you know, I do think that making it to a bestseller, what an incredible, humbling moment. You know, it clearly shows that hearing people are hungry for more deaf stories and that they're interested in our community. And, you know, I don't think this would have happened 10, 20 years ago. I think the timing is right, especially with CODA and with Audible, both taking to the Oscar stage. You know, this year really is, it feels like our time now. It's not just for me, but for all deaf people.
Were you nervous about anything in the book? Were you concerned about, like, putting one particular thing out there that you hadn't mentioned before in the public?
I would say the thing that was maybe the most nerve-wracking was specifically the part that I talk about the relationship with my father.
Yeah.
You know, growing up, I, in fact, was in an abusive environment, you know, and of course, while, you know, the blame lies with my dad, I don't entirely fault him for the fact that he experienced language deprivation growing up and that he came from a family that didn't communicate with him. You know, he was really limited to signing in a school environment, and that's really tough. But I think what's the hardest part is trying to explain that to a wider audience that, you know, while I can't forgive a lot of things, I want to show that there is a real source and a real cause of those issues, and that I don't think he could really share so much of the fault as much as the system does. And those things really made me who I am to this day. So I'm happy that I put it in.
Do you know if your father's read the book? Would you want him to read the book?
Well, I have never asked. You know, I never asked him for permission to include the stories because it really felt like my tale. And it felt like, you know, I wanted to, of course, frame him in the right light and show that this was a systemic problem. You know, if he didn't like it, you know, that sucks. But, you know, I mean, I don't really talk to him. We're not in communication.
What have been some of the reactions you've gotten from people, from speaking and people in the deaf community? Anything stand out to you, a moment?
I think it's really interesting. I was just talking to someone the other day, actually, Who is deaf from birth, came from a hearing family, but really strongly identifies as a deaf person, went to deaf schools and was a part of the community. But she said in reading my book that truly it added to her deaf identity and to her deaf pride. And that, you know, the book mentioning so many historical moments and so much of our past as a community helped her really realize how much of history has really fueled her and her identity and helped her really remember so much, right? Of course, she's identified as a deaf person, but for her to be able to sort of add that additional layer of pride and really deaf it up, as I like to say, you know, to show that there's really nothing wrong with you, of course. You know, it makes me think that I've maybe hopefully had another impact on other people who maybe don't have as such strong of an identity as a deaf person. But as well, you know, in talking about my sexuality as queer, you know, it was really tough for me to put that into words because our community is incredibly small. But I wanted to really share my story and show that, you know, my orientation is, you know, something that really is a part of me. Of course, that meant losing a lot of my privacy, but a lot of the comments that I was getting from young deaf kids and talking about this was, you know, that they could connect to me and that they saw somebody who really reflected a piece of them. And that was something that was missing for me when I was growing up. And I'm very thrilled and very grateful that I'm able to provide that, you know, that added layer, right? I want to be able to be aspirational to those kids.
And the name seems so fitting, and I wonder, was that always going to be the title, or was there another working title? When did Utopia come into the picture?
Well, funny. So when I wrote the book, and it was completely done, you know, the first manuscript was out, and I had the draft, and I gave it to my team, and they said, where's your title? And I said, yeah, I haven't exactly specifically come up with one yet, because coming up with a title is really hard. You know, I've always really hated playing with, you know, sort of like the deaf or the hands or, you know, the kind of puns that I think are so overdone and sort of tropish, you know. I didn't want to stylize something that had been done. I wanted to get direct into the point, and I wanted to make it clear the second that you see it on the shelf. And everything that was thrown at me, I just thought didn't fit. But Deaf Utopia really worked. I don't really remember where it came from, to be honest with you. But it was something that I just felt really right. And I thought somebody else has had to have used this, right? I mean, Deaf Utopia just seems so perfect. I thought there's got to be something out there. But in Googling it, there was nothing. And I was like, really? Out of all the things? Because for me, the term fits so well. I came from a deaf family, and you know, my growing up really felt utopian in so many ways. I also felt that considering how many hearing people really see deafness as a negative, I could actually play with it. Right? So many people assume that hearing impaired might be better, but I wanted to really reclaim deaf in the title as something that could be incredibly positive from a community that thought that it might be negative without focusing on the hearing loss aspect. Utopia, which is such a positive ideal, right? Putting that together, I wanted somebody to walk into Barnes & Noble and see that with this negative and positive and pull from that juxtaposition that they might be interested in reading the book. That's how we ended up at Deaf Utopia. I think it fits.
Yeah, it does fit. It absolutely fits. And I love the story that you tell about the doctor and his reaction when he told your parents that you were deaf. And if you could share that for anyone who hasn't read the book, because it's beautiful.
Well, there's a lot of deaf people in this room, so I'm sure you know this story quite well. But oftentimes when a deaf kid is born, they have the hearing test, and doctors come in and they break the news that your baby has failed the hearing test. And they come into the room and they're solemn and they're upset and they apologize and they comfort you. Your baby has failed a critical test, right? And that sets the tone for the rest of your deaf baby's life from the first day. But to so many deaf people, right? I mean, we have deaf people all over the world who do incredible, amazing, groundbreaking things. And 30 years ago, a doctor came in and said that to my parents. And my parents jumped for joy. They were thrilled. And the doctor said, wait, why are you excited that your baby is deaf? And they said, well, we're deaf. This isn't a bad thing. This is fantastic, right? Nyle now is the fourth generation in an incredible deaf family. Now, 4 months ago, my oldest brother had a baby. And 4 months old, the baby is deaf. I'm thrilled. The doctor came into the room and told my brother and my sister-in-law, congratulations, your baby passed the hearing test. He's deaf. And immediately they said, what? Right? Right? And it just shows, I mean, how much things have changed in the last 30 years. It's very exciting.
That's so beautiful. And you're a part of that change, you. And I think about your mother, and this story is such a love letter to his mother. Mother, right? Mother?
Yeah, mom.
I feel like I know her, and I want to meet her, and I want to come over to your house and have coffee with her. She was such a pioneer.
Absolutely. Have come over for pasta.
Yeah, yeah.
We'll have dinner.
Let's do it.
We'll have dinner.
We'll have chicken parmesan. But what was it like having that advocate in your corner? Because you're just, I think in the book, you realize how lucky you were to have her. And so many people don't, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It was an incredible privilege coming from a deaf family,
yeah.
Right? Because I was able to see generationally the improvements that had happened over time and the change that they were able to impact, and also the changes that impacted their lives, right? From my great-grandparents who didn't really have access to education, my grandparents who are still forced to study under oralism and had to advocate for themselves, you know, to my mother whose education was better in high school. They finally put an end to oralism and really supported using sign language in the classroom. So I was able to look up at these incredible journeys and see how access and how education had shifted. And I was able to see my mom, who had observed the same thing, become an advocate for our community. And I could see more change now in the future, right? It's incredibly easy to be deaf. I mean, it's always been easy, don't get me wrong. But now, with the advent of technology and with the access, it's getting easier. And I'm incredibly thankful to my mother for that, because I think it's a real core memory for me to be able to see my mom work out rallies in front of my school, right? For her to be able to, you know, argue with educators and with principals. And those things are really ingrained to me now. I think so much of the work that I do is really to emulate what she did. So much of it is supported by what she did for furthering access to education and to language for deaf children. You know, it's something that I'm trying to push forward because, you know, had my mother not, I think, you know, she could have been completely self-centered and I might have ended up the same way, but yeah.
I don't see that happening at all. Why was it important to you to include history of ASL, history of the deaf community, the mention of gloss, the explanation of gloss, using gloss, and for anyone who doesn't know what gloss is, maybe you could explain that as well.
Sure. So, in telling my story, I always open up with a prologue that mentions history, essentially, and, you know, something that happened in the past for our community and how it sort of relates to the story or the happenings within that chapter, right? Some things that happened as a kid and how that impacted me. And it was really important for me to do that because before the writing process, when I partnered up with Bobby Siebert, one of my closest friends, before we actually dug into some of the deep writing, we had to look at structures and formats that we might want to use. Of course, with any book, you would essentially plan it out ahead of time. And we read a lot of memoirs. One memoir that really stuck out to me that I was a big fan of was Trevor Noah's Born a Crime. And I loved it. Such a good book. But he had woven in so much history into that and in the telling of his own story, which really thrilled me. And so I took what he was able to write about apartheid in South Africa, right? You know, because many of us know about apartheid, but do any of us really understand the impact that it had on communities and on real people? And learning how that had an impact on Trevor Noah was really incredible, right? I mean, I knew a little bit, but I didn't know enough. And I felt that, you know, much of our community and much of our world might know about deaf oppression, but they don't know enough. And I thought, this is something that I can relate to my own experience and I can begin to introduce this to a wider audience. So pulling in each prologue more history, I think really enriched it. I think it was a wise choice.
It absolutely was a wise choice. Did you research it yourself? Did you work with a researcher? You probably knew a lot of it too from school.
Yeah, so deaf schools, I have to thank for teaching so much of the deaf history in classes. It was something that was always ingrained. You know, we were certainly forced to learn. And of course, history might not have been my favorite. I actually hated it, if I'm being honest. Huge fan. I thought, who cares, right? But it was really ingrained by our teachers and professors that it was important that we learn, and that was drilled into us growing up. So, you know, most of it really I knew by heart already. You know, none of it was really news to me.
Love it. And I love how we learn how how mischievous you were. You were really hard on your mom and stealing the car. And do you still have that energy? Are you still like that? Or have you settled down a little bit?
Well, I think I've settled a little bit, definitely. But, you know, I still like my adventures. You know, I definitely like to feel an adrenaline rush. I really enjoy the mischievous side, but I have tamed it a little bit, you know. My mom can stop growing gray hair, I think. I can give her a break. But I do think it's interesting because growing up, I was mischievous and I was incredibly stubborn. I was incredibly stubborn. My mother always told me I was as stubborn as a mule. And it was something that I really, you know, kept with me. I mean, like most boys are, I'm a Taurus, right? Yeah, you know, we're quite stubborn. But, you know, I've really learned that being stubborn is an incredibly good trait in the entertainment industry, where it's really tough to carve out a place. It's an incredibly cutthroat industry. And you have to be stubborn in a good way, right? You have to stand your ground, so...
We like that you're stubborn because it's gotten you to this place. It's incredible. I loved learning that you've been perseverant since the day you were born, right? Like your mother had a moment where she thought she might lose you and she was having trouble with the pregnancy, correct? And when she was giving birth, you were the last to come out. Your brother Nico came out first. So I think it's just so telling about the way you live your life because you've been a fighter ever since. Do you look back at that moment and go, oh gosh, it was right from the beginning?
Right. No, definitely. You know, I think it really took me a lot to write this book, and it helped me realize why I'm in this industry, why I'm on this earth, you know, that I do have a path sort of carved in that sense. You know, from the womb, I, you know, where I almost died, I absolutely was, you know, I was still stubborn. I wasn't sure if I was ready to greet the world yet, and I wanted to do it on my terms. But I think it really reflects in a larger metaphor sort of who I am. A lot of the stories in this book, you know, are about me getting lost or wandering off or just escaping because of curiosity of what's on the other side. And in my childhood, it's really interesting to look back because I still carry those traits. You know, while I might not be in the deaf community as much anymore, working with hearing people, you know, those are still very much a part of me, right? You know, you can take the country out of the girl sort of thing, but I always like to test my boundaries in many ways.
You had this moment where you said you were BMXing through the woods and you didn't know where you were going, but your instinct just brought you to that, to the end of the line where you finally got your way home. And I see you living your life that way now. Still, you just keep pushing and pushing. And I love watching
Absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. Yeah. In this industry, I mean, I still say that I'm incredibly new, right? And in producing things like Deaf U and with Audible, you know, while I have a few more projects still coming, like Deaf President Now, which is a limited series coming, you know, we have the Deaf Punk Show that's coming. You know, with all of that, I'm still learning, and I'm learning on the spot. I have to be very adaptable, right? This isn't like I came in with some sort of history or some sort of knowledge. I often have to partner with other production companies, you know, with pitches and how to approach Netflix, right? Netflix could ask me and say, why should we buy this show? And I have to come up with something immediately, right? Based on the little bit that I know about this industry. And that's really exactly it. I'm still on that bike in the woods and I don't know where home is, but I'm hoping that I find it.
I love that. Let's talk a little bit about Hollywood because it suits you well. I think it's just fascinating how the phone changed your life, because if you weren't on Instagram, if you weren't social, this casting director from America's Next Top Model would not have found you, wouldn't have seen your face on there, and it's just steamrolled into this incredible career that you have in Hollywood. Take us back to that moment when you met the casting director for the first time. Did it feel right? Did it feel right in the moment? Or were you just nervous and like, what am I doing here?
Well, you know, when the casting director first, you're talking about when they first approached me for America's,
for America's Next Top Model.
Well, now, even before Instagram was Instagram, right? We're talking 2015 when Instagram was literally nothing. It was, you know, it was full of weird filters that were really annoying, right? You had the Balenciaga with the frame on the outside, right? There was nothing really there. You had no choices but down. Somebody had reached out to me. I was a casting director and said, hey, you know, I'm on the show. I think you'd be a really good fit. You've got a great look. What do you think about America's Next Top Model? And at first, I was like, that's a scam, right? Do you remember Instagram in 2015? constant scams. Yes. People were always coming up with something insane to serve you. But with more and more persistence from the director, I thought, maybe this is legit. So I went back and I said, listen, do you know that I'm deaf? Are you, you know, even able to cope with that on your show? And they said, well, we don't know, but why don't you give it a shot? And the rest was really history. But now in meeting with the casting director, I was really nervous. Yeah. Because I wasn't sure what the steps looked like, what happened next. I wasn't sure if in the meeting they say, yes, we've chosen you, you're on the show, or I get on a plane, or whatever the case is. But it wasn't really clear. You know, I was, you know, going back and forth with them on, you know, Skype and texting back and forth. I didn't have an interpreter. It was, you know, a really interesting meeting, but I was motivated and I certainly was eager. You know, the group definitely felt that it was the right time for that opportunity and I felt that it would be a good fit and I just went for it. But, you know, much later when they forced me to speak, at one point I was like, oh God, it was awkward and embarrassing and I just, yikes. I remember, you know, when they said, Nyle, we want you to speak, tell me your name. Tell me your height and your weight. And I was like, oh, what? No, oh, I think they asked me where I was from as well. Yeah. And I did it, and I was so embarrassed. And I had a friend of mine who was willing to interpret for that meeting for free. And when it was all over, I said, how did I sound? Did I sound okay? Did I say it right? And she said, you were terrible. And I was mortified. Mortified.
But that's so Hollywood, right? Like that casting director pushing you and asking. I was so mad reading that. Like, can you speak? Why are you asking me that?
Did you ever confront her? In a way, I feel, you know, they wanted to believe that I was deaf, right? And, you know, there's really no other way for me to prove it other than write that to them in their mind. So I don't know, you know. I would assume a lot of people, you know, certainly out there would do literally anything to get on the show. Yeah. I mean, America's Next Top Model is such an exclusive opportunity, right? You know, there were other competitors on the show. There was one specifically, Bello. I don't know if you remember. He had the really incredible blue eyes.
Oh, yes.
But he literally went to 3 different massive casting events, right? He went to LA. He went to, I think, Dallas and Las Vegas. He had traveled, failed the audition until he got to Las Vegas where the team chose him. And they said, isn't this the 3rd time that we saw you? And he said, I'll do anything to get on the show. And they said, fine. Literally, people would give a pound of flesh to be on there. And I think that might be why, right? They would have assumed that I lied to them, even though they had reached out to me. It was wild.
Do you think that's why you won? Because you weren't willing to give a pound of flesh to be on there? It wasn't in your dream?
Right. No, I mean, definitely. I never really had watched America's Next Top Model. Yeah. I had heard about it from friends, but I think that helped a lot because I didn't know what to expect and I didn't know much about the process. I was really raw and I was eager and I was willing to try it out and just navigate it sort of as it came. And I think that definitely helped me. You know, certainly Dancing with the Stars was the exact same thing. I'd never seen the show. It was of no interest to me until I actually got there and I just made it work. But, you know, honestly, I always say I am the luckiest guy on the planet. You know, I mean, it's wild. I clearly have missed the cars that are coming just crossing the street. You know, honestly, I'm hoping that nothing happens to me from here on out, knock on wood. But
what was, explain a little bit about access on America's Next Top Model versus Dancing with the Stars, because they were very different, weren't they?
Yeah. So America's Next Top Model was really, really, really different. Because it literally quarantined us, right? You're in a massive mansion with all these other models in Los Angeles, and you've got to stay there for almost 4 months straight, right? You don't have access to the television. Literally, for 4 months, they had a terrible earthquake in Nepal, right? People were dying, and I didn't know about it until 4 months later. It was like getting out of jail, right? There was news happening around the globe that we had no access to. You know, we didn't have phone access. We didn't have internet. It was tough. It was really tough. So I had to really learn how to work with hearing people for such a long time. They gave me a phone called an OPA phone that didn't have any service that I was able to text. I was only able to text. And then I had an interpreter there that was really only on set for 10% of the time. It was for filming, nothing really in the house. I was always, you know, really fending for myself. So that was a really tough experience as compared to Dancing with the Stars, where I was much more comfortable because I wasn't quarantined. I was able to go back to my apartment and go to the gym. I was able to go to training and just go home. I was able to go to the beach with my friends and, you know, I could have gone out for drinks and a party and lived my life. I could have dated. It was, you know, it was great. But yeah, it was a much more fun experience. And I had an interpreter for the entire duration, which was great.
Do you still dance?
Do I still dance? No. No. I think the percentage I spend time dancing is zero, maybe. Maybe a little bit. I can still ballroom, but I pretty much forgot. Oh, I want to say I forgot. Ooh, yeah. Six. What has that been? 6 years? 5, 6 years ago now? Jeez.
So you've done any ballroom or any of the routines? Or once you got the ball, the mirror
nada.
Ball, you just left?
Nada.
Zero. Get up,
honestly,
let's do it.
Honestly, I'll tell you, I have PTSD literally because I was dancing for 4 months nonstop. I was so thin. If you look at me back then, honestly, my mom was like, you're a different person. Afterwards, my mom said, you need to eat. You need to eat. And I'm like, I'm eating. I'm trying. It's just so much time that you spend in the air, spend in the studio. Yeah.
At what point did you think, oh, I need to change the narrative and create shows for myself, for the deaf community? Coming out of that incredible scenario, you could have just kept just being a model. You could have just been an actor. You could have done your commercials and your endorsements. But when did you say, I got to change this if it's going to happen?
I remember, so after Top Model, right?
Yeah.
My mom came running onto set, and the first thing I told her, I said, I'm going to change the world. I'm going to change the world. And it felt right in the moment because I knew that I had a platform. I knew something would impact change out of all of this. And after Dancing with the Stars, I felt that I was on top of the world, right? That year journey really created an overnight sensation in me, and it was great. At the time, there were so many opportunities that I, you know, was up for. Acting, directing, right? All of it. But after Dancing with the Stars, I was back to square one, right? I would audition for a role and I wouldn't get it. I would meet with writers and directors and producers that always wanted to write me in, right? They were in love with me. They wanted to make a character. And it was always sort of a yes and no answer because they weren't sure how they could write a role for a deaf person that would sell a TV show or how great it would be in their narrative. And I realized that it was because they didn't have the experience to write an authentic role. I want to say it took me 2 years after Dancing with the Stars and a lot of failures, right? And now, a lot of people don't know this publicly, but I failed at a lot of those meetings. And I wanted to place the blame on Hollywood. I wanted to, but I couldn't because they didn't have exposure to the deaf experience. They didn't know any deaf people. But I now had a platform that I essentially could hijack and use to develop deaf content and deaf shows that would make an impact, that would inspire hearing people and create a structure by which they could emulate in their own content, right? To show them deaf people are in fact out here and we look incredible on the screen. Instead of the typical one deaf character that's one dimensional and very limited and incredibly surface level, right? I wanted more and I craved more. I wanted to see deaf LGBTQ+ identities on there. I wanted deaf families, right? I wanted to see people who lost their hearing late in life and were late and deafened, which is why I wanted to invest in Deaf U, which, funny story. So Deaf U was something that I had always wanted to do. When I was in college at Gallaudet University, my alma mater, it was the perfect place for a reality show. It just made so much sense. And there was so much drama. Holy cow, deaf people love drama. Honestly, it's a beautiful, gorgeous campus. And of course, it's an incredible access point for hearing people to learn about our culture and learn about our community. But the idea essentially was sparked out of some pretty wild shenanigans. In my fourth year, my roommate and I decided to set up a couch surfing account. You all know couch surfing, right? International people or even from the US can crash at your place overnight for free, right? They just get online and they say, hey, I'm in Berlin for the night and I can't afford a hotel room. Can I crash on your couch? And literally people find free couches and they just sleep there overnight. And we said, we have a couch in our dorm room. Why don't we get a couch surfing account? So we did it. And in fact, we would get hearing people to come, all these backpackers from other countries who would come and visit, and we never told them that we were deaf. Never once told them that it was Gallaudet University, yes. Nothing. So they would show up at the gate, nobody talking, they'd be like, what is this place? Right? They go into, they get to the US, but now they're in another country. And so people would stay for the night and end up staying for a week. They would learn sign language. They would fall in love with our community. They thought it was so cool and they loved how we partied. So we came up with so many stories out of that, right? And I knew that I could sell Deaf U, and that's how it happened. In the room with Netflix, telling them about what I actually experienced in college. And now we're seeing more deaf roles on screen, right? Now we're, we of course want to see more representation and more layers and more nuance from our community, but it's going to take more than one single show. And I always tell people, right, I'm deaf, absolutely. But this is not the best way to be deaf. To you, the best way to be deaf might be completely different, right? You gotta do you, baby.
Amen to that. Amen to that. So how did the kids react after the show aired and people saw it? Like, did you have to counsel them? Because you had already lived that reality show life.
So we had narrowed down essentially to six cast members, and all of them came from different backgrounds, you know, different races, obviously, different sexualities, different genders. You know, some had come into school with no sending experience. Some had come in with, you know, a whole experience coming from a deaf family and a deaf background. And we knew that they were going to be incredible just the way that they are. And when we were delivering the final contracts and when we put them on the show, almost all of them didn't want to be on the show anymore, right? And they all said the same thing. I'm not deaf enough to represent the deaf community. And the first thing I said to him was, that's the point, right? There are so many different kinds of deaf people on our spectrum, right? Even though we come from all places and all walks of life and all backgrounds, right? We have to show that there is in fact no one right to be deaf. We have to show that this is such a beautiful community and that we're not monolithic. And then our experiences all bring value into who we are generally as a community. But we also worked very hard to do something groundbreaking in Hollywood, which is to bring in 50% of the crew behind the camera from the deaf community, including when we interviewed cast. We wanted to make sure that the conversation that we were seeing was not somehow, a one-dimensional conversation happening with a hearing, you know, paternalistic interviewer. We wanted it to be between two deaf people, right? There's so many producers out there that say, don't you wish you were hearing? How hard was it for you when you grew up? Tell us about your struggles. Will you cry a little? But instead, we wanted deaf people essentially to have a conversation, which helped them become vulnerable and comfortable talking about the things that we love about the community and also our everyday experiences, right? That was the first time that that had ever been done in Hollywood history. And it was my goal because I wanted to show Hollywood that there is more room in the industry for us and that we can, in fact, create from our own community and we can develop. It's really my hope for other projects, right? Like Deaf President Now and for our Deaf Punk project, right? My work is really to bring more deaf people behind the camera and to give entrance to creatives who haven't been able to find the opportunities yet so that we can make our own shit.
And then there you were this year nominated, your documentary short for Audible. Gosh, like, was that ever in the vision? Like, you must have been in awe. And where were you? Where were you when you found out?
Whew, honestly, no. It was, you know, I've talked about this before, but in making deaf content, my goal was always just to increase representation, yeah. Right? And with Audible, I wanted to provide hearing people a completely new perspective that hadn't been seen before of our community. You know, that was the entire drive behind the project. But to be nominated for an Oscar was beyond my wildest dreams, and it was incredibly humbling. Incredibly humbling. You know, I think it's very telling that hearing people now are ready. Mm-hmm. They're ready to hear true and authentic stories from our community and from deaf people that are about deaf people and are produced and created by deaf people. I was actually at my sister-in-law's house when I found out she had just had a newborn. I want to say he was 4 weeks old, right? We were all watching the TV when they announced, and it was a beautiful moment. It was really thrilling.
And then for CODA to win that same night, were you familiar with the movie? Did you know it was being produced? And had you been able to spend some time with the cast and have some camaraderie with the other cast members from CODA?
Yeah, so I wasn't involved with CODA at all, personally.
No, yeah.
but I obviously did audition and I got turned down, which
okay. You auditioned? I didn't know you auditioned.
I literally did. And I didn't get it, which was fine because I lost to an incredible other deaf person, which was fantastic. It was the first time ever. Losing out on an audition and being passed up for a hearing person, the worst.
But how amazing you were there anyway at the Oscars. Isn't that incredible?
Right, right. Yeah. No, it was phenomenal.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was definitely something that felt meant to be, right? That night felt very much fated.
Horrible
And like
movie.
I said, it was very humbling.
It was a horrible movie. I'm kidding.
No. I did actually lose the night of the Oscars. I'm still a little bit burned, not going to lie. But it's fine because Coda won for us, so thanks.
Yes.
Especially for Troy Kotsur.
Yes.
I mean, I'm so happy for him.
Yeah.
Ugh, I think it's incredible. And now, you know, it feels like this really is so much more than a moment.
Yeah.
But instead, it's a movement, right?
Yes.
And I think this really is telling. But now it's up to people like us and, you know, myself and Troy and Millie and Lauren all to push this forward. And hopefully in 2 or 3 years, we're going to see even more people, perhaps from this very same audience in Hollywood.
I want to just before we're going to open it up for questions for everybody here, because I know a lot of you are
nice.
Dying to ask him a question, but I wanted to talk a little bit about how you dive into your queer life and your queer exploration. Was that difficult for you to put in written form?
It was tough.
Yeah.
It was tough because, again, you know, I do try to preserve what little privacy I do still have, but, you know, I felt it was really important because I wanted to be honest. I wanted to be raw, and I wanted to talk about how growing up I felt different. You know, and I'd always assumed that I was straight or that I had to like women. But there came an end to that. You know, the deaf community is incredibly small and oftentimes quite insular. You know, many of us, honestly, are very, and don't get me wrong, I mean, I love my deafness, right? But it happens. It happens in any community, right? You don't have to love every aspect about it. But, you know, I was very straight passing. I was very athletic and very masculine, right? And, you know, I just didn't have the traits that I assumed with queerness and with gayness. And, you know, I started seeing gay people and queer people who looked like me, right? And, you know, they suddenly weren't the normal anymore. They weren't sort of that sum of all parts in the community. And, you know, I came out at 26, and I kind of wish I'd come out at 12 or zero. Why not zero?
Zero.
Can I do that? Can I do that? But, you know, in writing this, it really helped open my eyes when people had approached me and said, you wrote my story. You know, you gave me confidence on my journey or to start my journey. And I think that's really beautiful and something that I want to encourage. So it's tough, but I'm happy that I did it.
And there was a story that stood out to me where you mentioned that you were kind of saying that you're obsessed with the green Power Ranger, but then you realized it was really you were obsessed
pink.
With the pink.
Oh, pink.
The pink Power pink. Ranger.
Yeah.
But pink. You're really, but.
Okay, so it's kind of funny. So I asked my grandmother when I had came out, and my grandmother said, listen, I know, I've always known you were different. And I said, how? She said, your favorite color was pink. And I laughed, but it's true.
Yeah.
I told her, you know, pink doesn't mean that I was gay. Pink was, you know, powerful and it was incredible. I mean, I get that that's the stigma that's out there, right? But to me, I love pink. It's powerful. My hearing aids are powerful. I had a guitar that was pink. You know, I had everything that I had. My whole room was painted pink. I was obsessed with it. 3 years in high school, my senior pictures were pink too. Like, yeah, no. I broke my hand 3 times.
Pink cast.
Yeah.
Yes.
Of course. Every time. Pink cast. But yeah.
But I love how you said you realized.
I think that was me really probably trying to tell people, you know, maybe a cry for queerness, right? Like, listen, do you see all the pink? I mean, my family still didn't get the hint at all. Except my grandmother.
And then I love how you realized it was actually the green Power Ranger was the one you were attracted to and you wanted
to be. Oh, yes. Yes. No, honestly. That was a really interesting moment how in watching, I was like, I love the pink Power Ranger, but I think it's just the color of a costume. And when things really shifted, I really wanted to be her so that I could date him. The green Power Ranger was a vibe. He was hot. Come on, he had the ponytail and the hair. Oh, God. I mean, right? You're team green Power Ranger over here. Thank you.
Well, funny you should mention that.
Wait a minute. What is this?
I got your little gifts. Open it up. I thought I wanted to make your dreams come true.
Yes. Oh, I finally got a man. Finally got a boyfriend.
He's a little more muscular than the original guy. I thought you might like him.
He's perfect. The bigger, the better.
Okay, with that, I'd like to open it to a Q&A for you guys to have a chance to get to talk to Nyle a little
bit. Thank you so much, Matt. Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
This means a lot.
So our format for the Q&A, we would ask that you please raise your hand. We have myself and another house assistant who will be passing the mics. If you need an interpreter, please let us know. We have two available. And we ask that you please say your name, ask a question, please, and then try to keep it as concise and brief as possible. If you would please raise your hands, I can start taking them now. Oh, yep, I see one down here. Got our first
hand. All right.
Hi, my name is Debbie. And I love your mother. Hello, hello, hello. We're sorority sisters, so hello.
Hey.
But I do have a question for you, both for America's Next Top Model as well as the other show, Dancing with the Stars.
Yep.
Right. So how long between the two shows, did you have to keep it secret before you were able to tell people that you were on those shows?
So we had already filmed that way before it was actually broadcast. So I knew that I was one, but I couldn't. I knew that I won, but I couldn't tell anyone for 7 months. Oh. I had to keep a secret for 7 months. My friends would be like, "Did you win, babe? Hey, you can tell me. You can tell me." My lips were sealed for 7 months. It was so hard, even with friends and family. You know, to the point where they started to think that I lost because I wouldn't break. And then when they found out that I won, they were all like, "What?" But it was great. Yeah. I felt sorry I couldn't tell you, but the whole point was the shock, and it was worth it. It was really great. Everyone told me that they thought that I'd lost because I literally would not crack. Dancing with the Stars was filmed live, so that was every single week. So when, I found out that I won, everybody at home did too.
But didn't your mom know too? Because she was there.
No, my mom wasn't on the secret. Yeah, right. Which is really lucky because I had a support system.
Wow.
Right.
Okay.
So we could talk about it together, which really let me breathe a bit. But had there been anyone? Had there not been anybody? I don't know. Well, there were some people that I could tell, but in the deaf community, it's dangerous. You tell one person, 500 people know the next minute. Right?
Yep,
you know.
Yep, don't do
you know.
Hello, I'm Peter Cook. So, hello. I know your mother from college.
Ooh, was she a good girl in college?
And all people fell in love with your mother, by the way.
Oh, definitely, definitely. My mom should write a book, 100%.
But, so I'm a little bit curious. You've been representing Hollywood, deaf people in Hollywood and across the world and on the world stage. And you've been really telling our stories via poetry, but there's a world in that, in and of itself. And you're just now bringing it forth.
You know, I think a lot about that and about how I'm introducing hearing people to that really beautiful world of sign language and our visual vernacular. I do think that we're sort of arriving to that point. I think we're still moving towards that point. But I also do think that right now, I'm trying to create different content to really build that foundation, that will really build that awareness of sort of how we're different from deaf people and how our culture is so rich and how our community is so robust. And I think with building that out and being able to sell that, it makes hearing people ready for the things that we want, right? You know, after Deaf President Now and Deaf Punk, while those are historical stories, I wanna see some wild things. But I also have to have the foundation laid first in order for those other things to be sold, where we can get to a place where we're moving into a more poetic, more abstract space. But you know, I would love to include those people, who are experts in that in those shows, right? Who are able to bring in pieces of poetry and visual vernacular, which is such an exciting part of our community, but also a thrilling part of my work.
Got another question over here?
Yeah. Can we lower the house lights a little bit?
Hello, my name is Crom.
Special.
And also, how do you think about investing in deaf people in the future in Hollywood? How do you then see this foundation? Have you considered creating an initiative or other foundations so that people can create their own stories? So that way that can then get pushed forward and then sort of proliferate from there.
Of course, setting up a foundation is totally possible. And, you know, the motivation is always to empower deaf people to tell their own stories. But, you know, for the deaf community to develop ideas, you know, one, you can pitch that to a production company and you can pitch that to me, right? That's what those meetings are for finding those incredible ideas and incredible access points into the industry to be able to develop more content to buyers like Netflix and Amazon and Hulu and all those, but also, you know, in the broadcast space as well. That's really what my production company was established for. And I'll tell you, I do absolutely meet with deaf people on a regular basis. We're pitching one show actually right now that's a deaf show that we've worked on for several months, which is really exciting. It's something that I love doing. And my goal is to absolutely empower those stories through my company.
Hi, my name is Allie. I am hearing. However, I am learning sign language at Columbia. Sorry, in college. And how I'm learning the language while simultaneously respecting the culture. How do I do that? How do I then do that both for school and in the deaf community while learning while simultaneously respecting?
Here, can you come closer?
Is there any way to dim these lights coming towards the stage at all? I know it's
Yeah, these
hard.
Are killing me. These are killing
it's,
me, friends.
Okay, I'm just asking because it's really hard to see what they're saying.
Mm-hmm. So I was just saying that I am hearing and I am learning sign language in college.
Right.
And not from the deaf community. So how can I learn sign language while simultaneously respecting the culture?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, I think that's by really getting yourself involved in the deaf community, right? Being a part of amplifying deaf voices through the community and through social media, which is, you know, where a lot of deaf people are trying to raise awareness and trying to tell their stories. You're able to be an agent of change by amplifying their stories and empowering them even more, right? Essentially, you can be the bridge between us and a wider hearing audience. And, you know, I 100% think that that's what you can do, right? And there's a huge deaf community here in Chicago. I mean, how many, we've got what, 75 deaf friends sitting right here. You're gonna make some friends tonight, I think. right here.
Thank you for the lights. It helped a lot.
My name is Janhavi from India. I am deaf, but know sign language a little bit and do lip reading a lot. I have been waiting to meet you since 10 years ago. I finally made it. I am studying normal art at the School of the Art Institute at Chicago. When I was in parties or programs where we're talking to each other and no one was deaf, I was very disappointed. Did you ever have the same feelings and what did you do?
That's been my experience in the Hollywood industry. I tend to be a lone wolf, right? I mean, Marley Matlin has been in the industry for years, but think about this. It's been 35 years since she graced the stage of the Oscars, right? And she still is the most widely known actress. So, you know, I really have been, you know, so much the only one in a lot of the spaces I'm working in places like Deaf U and Audible. I work to groom those people. I work to really never be alone again. That's the goal, you know? And I think, you know, bringing deaf friends with you to those spaces, right? Pushing schools and institutions to pull in more deaf people to be involved in activities and extracurriculars is one of the best things that you can do, right? We have to be able to ask for what we need.
I think we have time for two more questions.
Sorry if my signing isn't very good. I'm just learning ASL. I'm just taking one ASL class so far. So
you're an ASL 1 student? I'm impressed.
So I'm curious, with everything that you've done, all of the amazing accomplishments, what's next?
Ooh, what's next? That's a tough question.
Those tough, hard-hitting questions, yeah.
Honestly, I'm going to Mars. No, but Seriously. You know, my number one priority, my number one goal is to make Deaf President now. The limited series is certainly something I'm so incredibly passionate about, and it's such a huge part of our community's history. You know, Deaf President now wasn't just about putting a president into that seat, right, or about passing the ADA, but it was about Deaf people coming together and activating and really being proud of their Deaf identity. Right? And, you know, to 500 times percent. And I'm really excited about it. I hope to make more movies and more television shows. I mean, that's really my main goal. But yeah, Deaf President now is my focus. Right here? Yeah? That's such a tough question. It's tough because I think the first step to education in the first place is to empower Deaf educators. It's one of the largest problems that we see, right? Oftentimes, Deaf educators are removed from the conversation. It's where hearing educators are running the program and designing the curriculum in Deaf schools that we see a lot of inequities happen. We see that great divide, and it's not fair. But I think really first is to bring in Deaf educators, certainly into Deaf programs, and to allow them to lead, right? They know exactly what needs to be implemented for Deaf kids. To be honest with you, I think that that's the biggest battle that we have, and I wish that I had such a better answer that wasn't so specific, but, you know, I'm not an expert in Deaf Ed, but I can tell you that I really think that's the first step. Of course.
I think that's all the time we have for questions. Unfortunately, yes, we have to cut it off. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
But that was beautiful. Wonderful questions, everybody. I want to ask you one thing. For the hearing audience that is here today, what are two things that they can do to help bring awareness of the Deaf community to the world?
I think the biggest thing is to amplify Deaf voices.
Yeah.
To amplify those creators out there. I think that's the best way to really move things forward and make our culture and our community much more mainstream. I think that the second thing is learn sign language.
Yeah.
Because really, that's how you can better become an ally to our community and to the people within it. You know, I mean, ASL is incredible. Why not learn it? I'd say those two are the probably best piece of advice I could give. Thank you all so, 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 so much for coming. And thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. This was wonderful. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.